few years ago, the Sentinel Group released a documentary video entitled Transformations. It highlighted the wonderful work of God in four distinct communities, communities whose only common attributes were dysfunction and despair. The video's reception around the world was both remarkable and gratifying. In thousands of cities, it stimulated a new hunger for prayer and unity. A few viewers, however, stumbled over the word transformation. They wondered how transformation could be claimed in places where social blemishes remain. But transformation is not synonymous with perfection. In this present fallen world, there are no perfect communities. Transformation is more accurately related to sanctification. It is both a state and a process. How we define a community depends on our perspective. Is the proverbial glass half full or half empty? I believe a community's distance from perfection is less important than the distance it has migrated from its former state. Community transformation is not about great meetings or even church growth. It is about the gospel making a tangible impact on society as a whole. How long the condition lasts depends upon the individual community. Our ministry here at the Sentinel Group is to sow seeds of hope, to inspire confidence in God, and to create a greater appetite for His presence. And I trust this coming presentation will do just that.
城市转化这个第二集里面特别讲到乌干达。那当我在去年，也就是2001年，九月，我在以色列，当我听到乌干达就是那一位牧师就是 John Mulinda， 他特别提到在乌干达神做的工作。当我听到神在那里做的工作的时候，我心里面非常的兴奋，看见神在这样一个国家几乎是没有希望，在人看来没有希望，甚至连乌干达的政府他们都觉得用尽一切的办法没有办法解决他们国家的问题，特别是艾滋病的问题。所以当他们转向教会，对教会说，你们的神既然是全能的，我们已经用尽所有的办法，我们没有办法改变这样的一个情形，所以好不好你们教会来仰望神，来依靠神希望能够看有一些什么样的一个转变。那我们感谢神，我们看见神在乌干达的教会里面他们接受这样的挑战。当他们一起聚集在来到神面前，他们在神面前呼求，他们在神面前悔改，他们在神面前同心一起连结在一起，他们那个呼求真的是好像是呼天抢地的，在森林的里面，在各个地方他们祷告。但是当他们祷告的时候，神对他们说，你们不要单单为艾滋病祷告，你们假如为这个祷告，我可以解决这个问题，但是撒旦他可以制造层出不穷的问题，所以你们的问题真正的根源不是艾滋病的问题，而是跟神之间的关系的问题。所以当他们恢复跟神之间的关系，他们来到神面前说，神啊，求你来赦免我们，求你来赦免我们的国家。当他们一起来到神面前，神感动他们不要先为乌干达祷告，要为他们邻附近的国家来祷告。当他们顺服神这样的祷告，迫切的祷告的时候，就看见神开始在乌干达这个国家里面做一些奇妙的工作。那特别奇妙的就是看见艾滋病很多的人得到痊愈，而且整个教会也从荒凉变成复兴，看见神做一些非常奇妙的工作。所以我们真的 感谢神，我相信当我们一起来看这个 VCD 的时候，我们会看到里面的见证，我们一定会非常的感动。
我为什么要去乌干达？因为从1999年开始，我参加每一年都参加在耶路撒冷举办的世界各国为以色列求平安这样子的聚会。那在那个聚会当中，我会见到超过上百的国家的与会的代表。那每一国的在每一国的报告里头，我会感受到他们的属灵的程度，还有他们对神的热心。那乌干达这个国家从3年前就一直不断的因着他们的团队的合一，还有他们在属灵征战里面的能力，对灵界的认识，他们对神的那个爱不需要教导的自然的迸发的爱，这些东西就让我印象非常深刻。所以一直到今年初，今年1月我有机会，我就去参加他们的非洲大会。那在那个大会里头，我们大概经历了差不多接近2个星期的聚会。那我见到他们我不会说的令人这个眼目一新，他们从最高的高官到平民百姓对神的那个充满了盼望，然后充满了活力，在一个非常悲惨的国家，居然有这样子的力量，这样一直不断的涌现。我回来再看那个录影带，就发觉那个转化的录影带，它居然捕捉到的跟我们亲身去体验的经验其实是很接近。那我想父亲的火会烧得这么好，跟他们的谦卑，还有他们几十年来日子实在过得太惨了，他们真的过了那种人间地狱的生活，不管是在政治上，在经济上，在老百姓的生活，因为艾滋病的关系，他们都一层一层的打击，而且是很无情的，很强烈的，生命的剥夺，很大的考验。所以我想在这样子的状况，他们从这么惨淡的状况里头，绝望里头，再重新起来，所以他们的我觉得不是偶然，他们现在有这样复兴的表现不是偶然。
Establishes order in the heights of heaven. Can his forces be numbered? Upon whom does his light not rise? What is man that you are mindful of him?
Having observed God's willingness to transform discrete territories and cultures, only one question remains. Can this happen at a national level? Is there any evidence of God at work in a modern state, a sovereign nation? The East African nation of Uganda seems an unlikely place to look for answers. Racked with demonic fevers, this one-time pearl of Africa has spent decades in a deep spiritual coma.Its very name has become synonymous with death. As the nursery of AIDS, and as Idi Amin's personal house of horrors.
I think Uganda has been a country of pain, a country which has gone through one military coup to another.
I know what it means to live in fear.
Pastor John Malindi was a teenager when the horror began.
People have been killed in thousands, massacres, whole villages being massacred. And sometimes you would not know exactly who is doing the killing.
Those who listen to John Malindi's vivid tales may squirm.
His body lay there for 2 days.
Or even weep.
and the baby had pulled out the breast of a dead mother.
But they will always remember.
We did not recognize what we were fighting against.
Uganda's history, like that of many African nations, is filled with magic practices and secret rituals. Fetishes known as Mayembe were everywhere. And kings, even to the days of Idi Amin, are known to have offered human sacrifices.
Africans are covenant people, if I may say. Much of what we have is covenanted to the devil.
Our history tells us that our ancestors worship other gods other than the God of Abraham.
For Uganda, the consequence of this idolatry has been a long season of fear and pain.
What I knew about Idi Amin was a towering figure with who wanted to throw around his weight and wanted his presence felt all over.
Journalist Mark Kukuza grew up under the shadow of Uganda's infamous tyrant. Like many of his countrymen, he was optimistic when Amin's overthrow led to the return of former president Milton Obote.
I'm now president.
But they thought that maybe Obote would be better than Idi Amin, but it wasn't.
There were powers of darkness behind these people that you're looking at, which were tearing apart this nation. In those days, it was common to find bodies lying by the roadside, and sometimes people would go to look over just to make sure, is it a person I know, a loved one? If not, they would just go on.
And it wasn't just soldiers doing the killing.
I was born to die.
Pastor Jackson Sinyonga was just 3 months old when his mother threw him into the garbage.
And my grandma picked me up.
Assuming he would die within a matter of days, an aunt agreed to take him in. But the boy lived, if only to revisit the pain.
My father was murdered in 79 during Idi Amin. And at the funeral, that's when I first saw the picture or the face of my mother. Never a letter, never a picture, no nothing. And I was already a teenager.
Sadly, Jackson's father was part of a national epidemic.
One day passed, 2 days without your loved one coming home. Then, you know, maybe he's dead. So the first place to go to would be Namave Forest. It was a forest of death. You could feel the spirit of death there, the heaviness of death.
Prayer meetings went underground. Pastors circulated between as many as 10 groups a day, always at great peril, and often arriving home in the wee hours.
The soldiers had power to do whatever they want. There would be road checks. I was stopped in road checks many times, and you would never know how you're going to come out.
On one occasion, a mother traveling with an infant was asked for the baby's identity papers.
And of course, the babies don't have identity papers, and the baby was snatched from her, thrown up into the air, and the soldier raised a knife, and the baby came and plunged on that knife. And by 1984, they began killing churchmen. They began killing pastors.
Pastor Jotham Mutebi was in the middle of a sermon when Amin's soldiers burst into his church with guns blazing. As the bullets tore through the sanctuary, several elderly women rose and made their way to the altar.
And when I saw them, I thought these people were so desperate and that they needed comfort. So I raised up my arms and prayed over them. But I came to learn later that the reason they came, they wanted to die with me, their pastor.
Instead, Pastor Mutebi and his parishioners were herded into hijacked trucks and taken to the dreaded Nakasero Center.
Just a few meters away from where we are was this Nakasero State Research Bureau. That was the torture chambers.
The sadism and violence were unspeakable.
They could put 60 people in a room that is just by 3 by 3 meters. And they are crammed in to the point that a person would die and stay upright, held up by the bodies of the other living ones. There were no investigations. Things would happen and that would be the end of it.
It seemed the entire world had turned its back on the horrors in Uganda.
Men have deserted us.
Millions died, the bodies clogging the Owen Falls Dam and the shores of nearby Lake Victoria.
We need to repent for whatever sins of our past. We defile our country. We are not any better than Cain.
This preoccupation with killing took its toll on the nation's economy and infrastructure.
The factories broke down. Essential commodities became scarce and almost unknown.
You couldn't get soap. You couldn't get anything.
The city was dirty, and most of your buildings were damaged.
The morals of the people were so broken that you could not get a single thing done without having to pay for it.
Just when it seemed things could not get any worse, they did. This time, the news was delivered by the World Health Organization.
It was being predicted that by 1997, AIDS would be so bad in Uganda that one third of the population would have died.
Dr. Patrobus Mufubenga is an accomplished physician serving with Uganda's National Institute of Health.
During this time, everybody was desperate. All of us, we are losing our dear ones.
Uganda has been crying to God, just like the voice was heard in Lama, women crying for their sons.
The pain, the suffering, the sorrow, the fear, no one could console.
They developed a saying before that said that the God of Uganda had gone to sleep.
In the middle of the night, there's one old man who stood up and pointed his cane to the pastors and said, "Where is this God you preach about? The God of power, the God who answers prayer. What has Uganda done to God? It looks like God hates us."
From the depths of the grave, I called for help. And you listened to my cry. I said, "I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple." When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you.
And they began praying day and night, day and night, day and night.
It came through a lot of crying, a lot of waiting.
There were times they had to go into the swamps and stay in the water, hidden in the papyrus reeds. So they would spend the whole day there, and in the night they would come out. And they would then get together and pray. This was deep, groaning prayer.
I am the man who has seen affliction. My eyes will flow unceasingly without relief until the Lord looks down from heaven and sees.
I would choose to seek God until he answers prayer. If he's not going to answer, then I would rather die seeking him.
Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning.
And the presence of God would come down as the people cried out to God, and it would be manifest to the physical eye, like a cloud, a heavy cloud of mist hanging over the people. When you walk into the meeting, you are immediately swallowed in. You know you're entering something that is tangible.
Fifteen years ago, this was one of the most dangerous places in all of Uganda. This community was known as the Beirut of Kampala, because under the regime of Milton Obote, undisciplined soldiers used to use the homes and shops in this area for target practice. Hopelessness hung over this community like a wet blanket.
It was into this place that God led a young Ugandan evangelist by the name of Robert Kayanja. He was accompanied by six intercessors.
This is our wailing wall where we used to pray.
Besides contending with lawless soldiers, Robert's team was also confronted by a powerful witch doctor named Musoki.
I mean, there was kind of a fear that walked with this man.
After being threatened with death, the intercessors cried out to God. Within days, it was Musoki who was dead.
After the death of this famous witch, Musoki, we begin to see the heavens open.
Kayanja's tiny congregation became a vast multitude. The Miracle Center Cathedral now seats 10,000 people, and the fellowship has given birth to 600 daughter congregations.
Uganda which had been written off by many, many countries, whose economy had totally collapsed, which had no voice at all, and whose people were ashamed of being called Ugandans, began making a turnaround. And the healing process began.
Not surprisingly, it is a change fueled by prayer.
So churches began to pray in zones. It's like bees. You can hear bees through the night. Every community praying, every zone praying. And I felt like, you know what? The enemy must find another city, but not Kampala.
Unity is another hallmark of the present revival.
The work that God has been doing in this land cannot be claimed by any individual or any church or any ministry.
Citywide pastors' gatherings are common.
God is calling us now together to pray together, to praise together.
It is really happening that God is bringing churches together.
To talk to each other, to appreciate one another.
What I'm trying to do is to go with those people who love Jesus, who preach the word of God. Sometimes you find me in Pentecostal churches. I do go there.
The body of Christ is coming together. I am overwhelmed.
The revival we are involved in now is for everybody.
And unity is not something we're praying for, but something we are thanking God for.
Even the dire World Health Organization report on AIDS did not shake the believers' confidence in God.
We have seen the AIDS virus healed, and the doctors go, wow, I can't explain this, but there must be a God up there somewhere.
I had chest pain, I had the skin rash.
I started vomiting.
These were terminal cases.
I lost the appetite. I couldn't eat.
People with full-blown AIDS.
I grew very, very thin as a pole.
After being prayed for, many sensed God's touch.
That there is something changing. That very moment.
That very night, the power of God came down. And I felt it.
Not surprisingly, these self-proclaimed healings elicited serious skepticism from medical caregivers.
Why have you bothered yourself to come here? Because your status and your appearance shows that you are a victim.
But in time, this skepticism turned to amazement.
My doctor looked at me. He was amazed. He said, hey, are you still living?
I was checked. There's no AIDS.
They read my name, Ruth Birabwa, HIV negative.
And they told me you are HIV negative, non-reactive. There's no virus in your body.
Then the rest of the symptoms start to disappear one by one.
God had healed me totally.
It was a refrain heard thousands of times across Uganda.
But as I talk to you right now, I have experienced over 372 AIDS patients being healed.
Uganda has been recorded as one of the first countries to see a decline in HIV.
We believe it's because of our prayer, and we believe it's because of the love and the grace of God.
It is also because Uganda has promoted abstinence and faithfulness as their primary weapons against AIDS.
I vowed before you that if you heal me, I'll tell all the people.
I will not die, but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done.
The power of God has also been manifested in the political arena.
I believe Uganda is in a new beginning politically.
In divine timing, God brought leadership. God began to put people in place.
God is working in this country.
Paul Atiang has held nearly every post in Uganda's government, including prime minister.
The Lord has always been with me.
But it's the Lord who makes character.
Beatrice Bayenka is a member of parliament from the Hoima district.
So I want to be more firm in everything that I do, and so that the light may so shine.
They expect us to reflect Christ.
Stephen Unyo is the nation's deputy police commissioner.
I'm one of those who believe that God must talk to me, especially in this type of job I am.
On a number of occasions, Unyo has seen God quell violent riots in answer to prayer.
And I believe, out of my personal experience, children of God, if we continue in prayer, there is nothing impossible.
But I've taken my faith up to the governmental level.
Cecilia Adam Ogwal is the fiery leader of Uganda's parliamentary opposition.
I am an ambassador of Christ. And I'm not ashamed to testify that anywhere I go.
As we saw the government changing and the spiritual realm being changed, we felt, you know what? The God of Uganda has not gone to sleep yet. the gospel has introduced new changes even in the structure of the government. Now we have a new ministry called the Ministry of Ethics and Integrity. We never used to have that.
God put me in this position.
God needed a tough person for a tough assignment.
And when I was tussling with getting born again, I told him, I want you to get me hold of me like you did with Saul on the way to Damascus. And he did it.
Miriam Matembe remembers the day she stood before the president and his cabinet to explain her portfolio. Her words were prophetic.
Do you remember the story of the children of the Israelites in the slavery and how Moses led them from the promised land? Here I am. I'm the Moses of Uganda. The Lord has appointed me here to lead Uganda from UNESCO conduct, moral decadency, corruption, to the right direction.
As the source of the river that once carried a younger Moses to his destiny, Uganda is again on the highway to history. And the journey is nowhere more evident than in the government's aggressive plan to build ethics and integrity in public office.
I knew that the battle is very hard and difficult, but the Lord is with me.
Today there's a lot of corruption in Uganda, but if we look back to how it was 15 years ago, it's just incomparable.
Judge Julia Sebutendi is a special prosecutor appointed by the president. A fervent Christian, her corruption-free reputation has brought new energy and credibility to the campaign.
What she has unearthed has shocked the whole nation, and people are trembling, big shots.
The files are full to refresh our memory. Talk to us.
She is what she is because she's born again, because she has stood her ground.
And to see that today people are coming back to this place of integrity is amazing.
We have seen God do great things until crime rate drops 50%.
Not surprisingly, this new attitude is impacting the national economy. While things are still tough, positive signs are everywhere.
The economy, which was predicted to collapse, has not collapsed as such, but it has been among the three fastest growing economies in Africa.
And Uganda's churches are growing even faster than her economy.
And we went from 7 people to 2,000 people in 2 weeks.
Not bad for a young man who was once tossed onto a garbage heap.
Today, it's amazing. We have 5 services on Sunday morning, and we're averaging about 20,000 people. And today, I'll tell you, our church is not the only church that God's growing.
And there is revival, immense revival going on within our churches.
Every day in Uganda, there is a new church starting up, or a ministry starting up.
Once we have set ourselves free from the sin of our past, then we need to focus on the purpose of God.
On New Year's Eve, 1999, Uganda joined the rest of the world in celebrating the arrival of a new millennium. But there was a special character to the Ugandan celebration.
His is the invisible hand that has moved us along and shaped our destiny.
10 weeks earlier, First Lady Janet Museveni had invited several church leaders to a meeting.
So when she came in, she told us she had a vision. As we enter the new millennium, can't we organize a time of thanksgiving to God for the way God has got us through this period?
I mean, she had requested that we dedicate the nation officially back to God.
Good morning to all of you. And Happy New Year.
So in the presence of the President and First Lady, we'd covenanted the nation to God for the next 1,000 years.
The covenant, which included the signatures of the President and First Lady, was remarkably explicit.
We are conscious that we have put other gods before you and before
It read like a passage out of the Old Testament.
Covenanting our nation, Uganda, to the purposes of God and to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Then the king called together all the people from the least to the greatest. The king stood by the pillar and renewed the covenant in the presence of the Lord.
From beginning to end, it was just God.
Let shame come on my face, O Lord, my God. Shame and reproach, Lord, come on my heart.
Watching these fervent assemblies, one is confronted with a glorious irony. Dictators once tried to destroy the nation's faith by preventing people from entering church buildings. Instead, the edicts and padlocks served only to remind believers that the church has nothing to do with buildings. When Uganda's faith was taken outdoors, into football stadiums, banks, hotels, even parliamentary offices, it flourished.
Jesus is standing on the right hand, telling the Father, Father, I'm ready for Uganda. And Uganda, that was once used to be the pearl of Africa, was now about ready to shine again.
It's amazing for people who lived at that time to see what is happening now.
Life has come. It seems that there's a new king reigning over the nation of Uganda.
Uganda is ready for God as a nation.
It's astounding.
It really is a miracle.
Nobody can deny it.
It wouldn't have been possible if it hadn't been for the Lord.
Make straight his path there.
To those who would ask, why did God move so powerfully in these particular regions? The answer is simple. He was invited.
And I think a spirit of revival works in a country. It must be invited. People must desire to have that spirit.
It's the kind of desire that deeply yearns to the Lord.
People are praying and they're seeking God as the realization that the only way out of this mess is God coming upon us and God cleaning up society and God making all things new.
If my people,
we must humble ourselves unto the mighty hand of God first.
If my people,
we can only move the spirit by our prayer. There's no other way.
Let there be prayer in every area of the land, in every town, in every village, in every church.
If my people,
Lord, we need to come. We can't do it on our own, but come to us, come visit us.
If my people,
there's a place to pray for a revival. There's prayer, there's tears of repentance.
Father my God, we pray that you carry out this surgery in the hearts of the people, Lord.
It matters to God more than anything else.
Remove the heart of stubbornness, the heart of unbelief.
He is really attracted to pure hearts.
And Father, give us the heart of flesh that loves you, Lord my God.
Then will I hear from heaven.
God will listen to the prayers of his people, fervent prayers. He'll listen to them.
He'll hear you. And you will know the faithfulness of God.
I will forgive their sins.
Since we got to know Jesus personally, God makes a big difference. Now we have hope.
And I will heal their land.
Miracles have been happening in this country, and we believe Uganda will never be the same again.
Oh, God is so good. I have seen this community just transformed by the power of God. Really.
There's going to be a time when the whole world is going to experience nations coming to maturity. nations come into the fullness of their purpose. That time is so near.
在看完这个乌干达复兴的 VCD 之后，我们要来思想乌干达的复兴跟对中国来讲，对台湾来讲，那可能带给我们怎么样的一个回响，带给我们怎么样的一种提醒，所以我们从这角度来做思想。过去二三十年在台湾的教会呢，都非常的看重教会增长的题目，很多牧师都关心的主题。但是这个教会增长运动从1950年代开始的时候呢，他们原先思考的重点呢，就是考虑到一个国家当福音传进去一直到现在的这整个过程当中呢，那大概我们去分析它可以分成一些不同的阶段，那譬如说有抵挡的阶段，有突破的阶段，然后有停滞的阶段，有这个逼迫的阶段，有复兴的阶段，所以他们就分析这整个发展的脉络，然后看看说是怎么样的抵挡，那这抵挡是怎么样的突破它，再思想到说教会为什么在这20年之内为什么处于停滞的状态，那因素在哪里，那后来为什么有复兴，那这复兴当中有成功的地方，有忽略的地方，那类似这样我们思想整个国家整体性的教会增长，然后来得到一些教训，那这是一个原来教会增长运动的一个主轴，那不是不像我们现在只要考虑的只是单一的教会的增长，那所以我们从这角度来思想整个乌干达它教会发展的脉络，从1877年福音第一次传到乌干达，那实际上一开始就受到很大的逼迫，所以在1886年的时候，当时的国王就杀了16个这个基督徒，那他们为主殉道，但是当英国真的开始介入，正式把乌干达成为殖民地以后呢，那教会就开始稳定下来，因为得到政府的保障，然后在1890年代就开始有小规模的复兴，在1910年代也有，那特别是1920到60年代的时候呢，是历史上非常有名的所谓的东非大复兴，在这大复兴的乌干达扮演一个非常重要的角色。那从这里我们也思想到一个很有意思的主题，就是好像我们看到在英国的殖民地，那常常的就是比较容易有复兴，因为在近代基督教历史当中呢，在宣教和复兴历史当中，英国一直扮演非常重要的角色，所以这些属于英国殖民的国家常常会有复兴发生，那这个在中国大陆也是很清楚的，所以等一下会来提到。但在乌干达从1871年的时候呢，安民开始执政，他是个独裁者，开始逼迫杀害很多的人，那在特别从1875年他宣布回教为国教，那然后就逼迫基督徒，一直延续到1907年他执政到1986年，然后逼迫才停止。这当中呢牧师被杀死，教堂被焚烧，基督徒要躲在丛林里面去祷告，是一个逼迫期，非常严重的逼迫。一到86年的时候，神兴起一个 John Mullidin， 他迫切的祷告，然后带动一个复兴。那复兴的情况我们在这个 VCD 里面我们看见那样的见证， 包含经济的繁荣，包含 AIDS 得到神迹性的医治，包含整个教会大量的增长，也包含这所有内阁官员差不多从总统以下大量的信耶稣，举行全国性的祷告会，宣告乌干达是以耶和华为神的国家。我们看到这样一个奇妙的见证。当我们回头来思想中国大陆的一个福音的历史，这是在1800年代进来，比乌干达早了77年，但是也是从英国的宣教士进来，一个马里逊但实际上真的比较能够进入内地是要到1860年代，这个内地会也是英国宣教戴德森的内地会开始宣教，然后福音才比较进入内地所以我们看到实际上真正进入的时间跟乌干达是差不多的也是透过英国的宣教士但是一直没有太大的增长，所以一直到1909年才有第一次的一个复兴，也是由加拿大人古约翰牧师那也是属于英国殖民地英国血统的然后到1925年到1945年是一个复兴的年代中间我们熟悉的像宋善杰牧师、尼托森弟兄这些人那1945年到1950年代的时候呢，也有一个学生当中的复兴，那所以它类似于乌干达的东非复兴的年代，在中国大陆同样是一个复兴的年代但是同样从1950年代的时候呢，当然这共产党主政以后也是一个非常大的逼迫，特别是1966到1976的文化大革命，那逼迫的那个严厉跟乌干达的阿敏执政是非常近似的可是到了文革结束之后呢，同样我们看到有很大的复兴发生，基督徒迫切祷告大量的信耶稣所以我们在这个对比当中呢，看见一个类似的脉络那只是说我们现在思想到中国大陆复兴跟乌干达比起来，特别在政治的层面上面，我们没有像那么多的这些政府高层人士都信主，而且宣告以耶和华为神我们期待在中国大陆神也能够做到像乌干达这样一种神这样一种强力复兴的一种程度那我们回头再思想到台湾的情形，那基督教进入台湾是在1865年，算是比乌干达稍微早一点点，但是也是非常的不容易，因为到1895年日本统治的时候呢，大概只有3000多人信耶稣，在日本统治时代我们也没有看到太大的复兴发生，也就是说在乌干达和中国大陆复兴的时候，在台湾并没有太大的复兴，那只有宋善杰带来一点小小的浪花而且当时教会还在日本人的要求之下呢，牧师带着信徒一起去神社参拜而且等等，所以我们看见说台湾当时属灵光景比较起来就是比较低落台湾要到1950到1965的时候呢，是比较一点复兴，国语教会当时有一个属灵的突破，那特别在外省人当中台语教会有所谓10年倍增运动，长老会也是一个突破但是1965年以后到现在呢，那教会还是停滞的不管基督教或非基督教的学者都统计出来，就是基督徒的比例从1965年的3% 到现在并没有什么增加所以虽然1965年到现在没有看到在乌干达和中国大陆这样的逼迫但是我们发觉说教会为什么没有能够突破大概至少几个原因，第一个1965年以后呢，这异教是非常的兴旺，不管佛教、道教、其他的宗教第二我们看到说呢，因为经济的繁荣，大家生活非常的富足所以呢基督徒呢又有些世俗化，不冷不热，那非基督徒觉得他生活非常的好，他不需要上帝来帮忙这也是另外一个因素第三个我们看到在基督教里面呢，不管是福音派或是所谓自由派呢，这理性主义都非常盛行，也就是说他们并不是觉得祷告很重要，他们也不觉得特别要呼求圣灵的帮助他们也对上帝的大能、神迹奇事抱着怀疑的态度所以这些可能都是造成台湾从1965年到现在呢，大概有接近40年时间呢，没有看见很大的复兴的逼迫到突破但是我们也想要戴明恩牧师最近的信息说现在是一个关键的时刻所以是不是说我们要来思想说说是不是好像上帝为了要促进台湾的复兴呢，他必须像乌干达或中国大陆用比较严厉的手段，甚至一种管教的方式呢，来逼着我们来寻求他所以在台湾已经有40年的福音的低沉呢我们是让我们觉得要来很谨慎的来思考，并且来迫切的寻求神否则的话可能我们会遇到像中国大陆乌干达的一种情形虽然结出复兴的果实，却就必须经过火炼般的试验这是第一个我在回应这个问题的一些的一种思考。 那接下来还有一个问题呢，是谈到就是说，从乌干达的复兴当中呢，我们认为在台湾现在我们应该推动的一个重点，到底是一个小组教会运动呢，还是像乌干达从86年的时候开始推的一个祷告运动？乌干达我刚刚提到86年的时候 John Mulidi 呢，他得到神的呼召，在当时的整个国家各个方面教会是软弱无力整个国家经济崩溃，道德败坏，政治混乱，在这样情况下，神跟他说你要起来，要到全国各地旅行去呼唤基督徒起来祷告，要让每一个基督徒的家庭呢成为一个祷告的殿，成为一个祷告的家。那他就禁食了90天，他很多的同工呢禁食60天、40天有几千个人，然后再发动很强的祷告运动。那之后我们就看到我们在录影带看到的见证。但是台湾在过去10年我们推动的重点呢是所谓小组教会运动，那小组教会运动到现在我们没有看见很明显的基督徒比例的提升，那所以或许我们思想说我们着重点或许应该像乌干达一样更多的强调祷告的运动。那这里面有两个思考的重点，那第一个从圣经来看呢，每一次当遇到危机的时候，就像历代志下7章13到14节那边上帝对所罗门说，若是在这地上有这些蝗虫啊、瘟疫还有这些旱灾，各式各样该灾难的时候呢，那怎么样解决的问题，就是必须要称我名下的子民自卑祷告寻求我的面转离恶行，我就赦免他们罪医治他们的地。那换句话在圣经并没有说当在国家有危机危难的时候呢，那基督徒若是起来大家努力做小组，努力带门徒，那就会神就会赦免这地的罪，就医治了地那所以这写很清楚是需要自卑祷告寻求我的面转离恶行。那这样一个模式是在圣经旧约到新约是一再的出现，有时候危机的时候呢，大家来悔改来迫切寻求神，然后危机才能够被挪开但在新加坡来讲呢，因为它的内政非常稳定，它外面没有强敌侵略的危机它也没有这种台风地震的这些情况那所以一说来讲它没有这种危机的情况。那香港它有中国大陆50年的保障，换句话也就是说在台湾我们现在面对实际上有从各样的危机当中呢，那可能我们最需要强调的不只像他们所推动的小组，我们必须回到圣经原则，是来悔改来呼求神，我们才可能化解到危机。可能单单小组祷告运小组的一个运动呢并不足以来化解危机，那这是从圣经的真理来看。那第二个我们从这个祷告所带出来复兴的果效来看，所以在我们录影带我们看到说有个教会，那牧师呢他2个礼拜从7个人增长到2000人但是香港我们所吸收的小组教会模式呢，那现在他们这个教会大概经过了10几年大概只有1200人所以换句话说在教会增长的这个速度来讲也是不一样的。那新加坡我们所吸收小组教会模式大概从600人经过了10几年现在大概接近10000人，可是在这个录影带我们看到在乌干达一个教会在不到10年的时间从6个代祷者增长到10000人，而且有600个分团那所以从教会增长数来看，我们发现祷告所带来的果效其实 是超过小组教会的果效，但是而且祷告带来不只是教会增长，它带来整个社会的改变。所以乌干达他们在祷告之后呢，我们看到它的这个通货膨胀从380% 呢降到6%，整个经济繁荣起来。但是香港最近情况呢，失业率非常严重，那经济问题很严重。那从政治的角度来讲呢，新加坡到现在基督徒还不能够公开在街上游行传福音因为政府要保障各个宗教平等可是在乌干达的情形呢，是总统带内官员公开在几万人的祷告会呢宣告耶和华是这国家的主。所以我们看到祷告带来复兴呢，对整个政治的影响，对整个经济影响那这也是小组教会所达不到的一个效果。那所以从这样来讲，我们觉得说我们已经推了10年的小组教会运动，那是不是我们应该考虑在祷告的部分呢要应该更加的加强，我们才能够期待在台湾面对危机的时候呢，我们可以带来一个突破，那甚至带来一个教会突破性的增长，带来社会国家政治经济各方面的改变。我想这是可能我们需要思考的方向。
感谢神神最近这1-2年，特别最近半年在台湾做了一些工作，那我们感谢主我相信这不是人手所做的，乃是神亲自因着他的怜悯，也不是因为台湾有什么特别， 而是说神他有他荣耀的心意，不但是在台湾，甚至在整个东南亚，在亚洲，甚至在全世界。所以我们感谢主，在过去一段时间，神开始把合一的这样的一个负担放在我们里面。虽然我们所了解的合一，虽然我们所一起在这里，就说当我们一些这样的连结的时候，我们其实是非常的肤浅。当我们现在回过头去看，我们在30年前，我们有几个牧者在台北一起聚集，其实现在回想过来，其实那是非常的肤浅的。但是感谢神，就是那一点点的神还是看重。虽然我们有时候在一起祷告，在一起交通，其实有时候感觉有一点勉强，有时候感觉好像有一点无聊，但是我们就觉得说，是我们不同的教会，我们在这里，我们在这个城市的里面，我们是应该一起分享，一起放下自己，放下自己的教会，放下自己的一些看法，能够一起来同心的来祷告。那感谢主，经过这样的一个几年，那其实好像看起来有一些的进展，但是其实我们现在回想过来，其实是非常有限。但是那样有限的聚集、祷告、分享，那样一个很肤浅的合一，而带来的慢慢看见，在各教会的里面一起的祷告，我们就看见有一些的突破。而那个突破特别就是在去年这个安卡罗布道会就会看见有一个很大的不一样。那这个不一样就是因为有一点的合一，有一些的祷告，然后连结起来，就看见有一些的转化，就是在台北整个特别在这一次布道会里面看见有一些的不一样。就说我们本来是感觉没有什么信心的甚至说实在说对场地、对讲员、对筹备都不太有信心，但是当我们往前的时候，我们就看见有很大的突破。在去年那一次安卡罗的布道会，3天的里面来了65000个人，然后有好几千个人决志，又上千个人得到释放，有人得到很多的人得到医治，而且整个布道的经费还有余。那这是我们觉得是有一个很大的对我们心态上的一个改变。以前过去在台北、在台湾有一个大布道会恐惧症，但是那样的同心、那样的一个合一、那样的祷告，把这个恐惧症有很大的一个转化、很大的一个改变、医治。那也是就在这个布道会完了不久，那我就到这个以色列去，完全没有这个期待，也不知道。那但是神就这样的一个带领，就让我在那个地方听见戴勉恩牧师在那里来分享特别合一的信息。那当他分享的时候，我就里面有很深的共鸣，好像把我里面好像知道又不知道的一些东西，就是再有一些的启发。而在这样的一个启发的里面，我后来有一点时间就跟他有一点的分享。那也提到他说可能会有机会来台湾。那所以其实当这样的谈的时候，也没有什么期待，也不知道神会做一些什么样的工作。但是当他来台湾的时候，那有一天本来我们那个聚会已经安排好了，后来我们有一些的调动。那在这调动里面，他在我们中间有分享2堂的崇拜。但是当他来的时候，神就对他说，他要为台湾的合一来舍命，要把生命摆上。那所以在这样的里面， 我们继续在那里那两堂的聚会啊，对我们有很大的帮助啊，好像感觉上面啊，就是在我们在合一上面的一个里面有更深的往前走。所以我们就筹备有一次的聚会，在世新会馆，在那一次聚会的里面，当我们召聚啊各个地方的一些牧者啊，就特别大台北市的一些牧者，我们在那次聚会的里面，我们就感觉到又往前跨一步，整个啊合一上面就更往前跨一步。而这个跨一步，所以啊我们就继续的有一次啊就全省的啊守望祷告大会。那在这样的守望祷告大会里面，我们就看见这样一个连结，不但是在台北，而且是在全台湾每一个城市。当我们在这个城市的里面，我们啊能够在那里堵住破口，医治伤口，堵住原住民跟这个平地教会的破口跟伤口，堵住客家教会跟这个啊其他教会的破口跟伤口，堵住两代之间的破口跟伤口，就是为父的心转向儿女，儿女的心转向父亲，也堵住两性之间的破口，就是当我们这些男人跪下来啊，向那些姊妹来认罪悔改，我们这些父亲跪下来向这些啊儿女来悔改，儿女跪下来来向父母来悔改，我们看见这样的一个悔改，就感觉到我们看见好像更深的往前。更深的往前，也感觉到整个啊台湾好像整个属灵的空气有一些的转变。那我们更感谢神，在这一次在那一次的聚集的里面，这个啊香港他们有好几位啊也来到我们中间，神也差派印尼的教会他们的祷告牧师主任牧师来到我们中间，他们啊对我们说，他们愿意成为台湾的膝盖，好让台湾成为基督的心腹。我们看见这一个连结，而且那一次也有马来西亚的牧师来，还有从加拿大来的牧师，从美国来的牧师一起，我们就看见这样一个合一连结，是一个更深的，而且是更广的这样的一个更深更广的合一，我们就更多的看见神做一些很奇妙的工作。所以最近啊我们刚刚有一个啊国度复兴的聚会，那埃克曼牧师，瑞典的埃克曼牧师，他说他在其他国家里面，当他在那里几天的聚会，常常是到第二天第三天好像才能够深入，但是他觉得在台湾的时候，第一堂的时候就觉得哎呀四五千个人他们非常的渴慕，那他发现说，因为在这里那个合一跟祷告整个属灵的空气啊带来的一个那种情形，所以聚会有一个非常大的不同，非常大的不同。那我想我们在这一个月，我们会再有一个全省更多的尝试，也是希望更深入的，也是更广的，能够在合一的里面来往前走。我们确信说神会在台湾各个城市来工作，那我们也相信说这样的一个工作不只是为台湾，我们相信神把我们跟香港的教会连结，跟新加坡的教会连结，跟印尼的教会连结，还有跟大陆的教会的连结，这些连结起来，我相信在整个华人的世界我们会看见一个更大的一个转变。那当我们也在加拿大跟一些华人牧师一起连结的时候，我相信在北美在全世界各地会看见有一个很大的一个突破，特别在华人的教会中间，我相信我们一起来祷告，一起来往前，会看见神的工作，好不好？我们一起来祷告。亲爱的天父，我们来到你面前感谢你，我们看见是你自己做的工作，因着你的怜悯，也因着你的手，主啊，你自己动了善工，我们相信你要成全这工，直到你来的日子。主，我们感谢你，主啊，你在乌干达所做的工作，在世界其他的地区所做的工作，我们相信主你不偏待人。当我们一起来到你面前寻求你的面，当我们一起来自卑祷告寻求你的面的时候，主，我们就相信主啊，你要来垂听我们的祷告，主啊，你要来赦免，你要来医治这地，不但医治台湾，你要医治世界各地，特别在华人居住的地方，让我们看见复兴临到， 让我们看见你的国降临，你的名被尊为圣。主，我们谢谢你，祷告奉主耶稣的名，阿们。
Sure as gold is precious and the honey sweet. So you love this city and you love these streets.
God promised in His word that in this last day He's going to pour out His spirit in a greater way.
Every baby laying on the bedroom floor. Every dreamer dreaming in their dead end job.Every driver driving through the rush of all. I feel it in my spirit, feel it in my voice.
When you are praying, don't back up. Pray until something happens. Press it forward until something happens.
For I can hear that thunder in the distance, like a train on the edge of the town. I can feel the brooding of the spirit. Lay your burdens down. Lay your burdens down.
The message is, don't slumber.Rise up and lift up the standard of prayer in the land. Press on to the end.
Revival is something that when you've experienced it, you always want to see it again.